As I mentioned in the Bible class session, it's great to be back and to be with this fine congregation. I have a lot of great memories of times in the past, being able to be here and to preach and to teach Bible class and do different things. I want you to know that the folks at Burleson look forward to next summer in 18. The youth group will be coming down for their stateside campaign and will be working with us, Lord willing, in July. I believe the date is the 18th, the Sunday at least, I think, is the 18th. And we look forward to having this group join us for that campaign and Vacation Bible School, and just want you to know how much we appreciate your willingness to do that. The Sermon on the Mount is the greatest sermon that has ever been preached. Its message is life-changing. If we will but hear it and heed it and do it. In my opinion, the sermon actually begins in Matthew chapter 4 and about verse 22. Because it talks about what Luke says in Acts chapter 1 concerning all that Jesus began both to do and to teach. And Jesus began His public ministry by doing and then teaching. The doing portion is listed here in Matthew chapter 4 and verse 22, where it says that Jesus went throughout all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing all manner of sickness and all manner of disease from among the people. And His fame went throughout all Syria. And they brought to Him all sick people who were vexed with various diseases and torments, those that were demon-possessed and epileptics and paralytics, and He healed them. And great multitudes followed Him from Decapolis and Galilee, from Jerusalem, Judea, and beyond the Jordan. These multitudes were gathered to Jesus because of the life that He lived and the deeds that He was doing. And then given that opportunity, as the multitudes came to Him, seeing the multitudes, He went up onto a mountain, and when He sat down, His disciples came to Him. And the Bible says that He opened His mouth and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be the sons of God. And blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And blessed are you when men will revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice! And be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets who were before you. You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt hath lost its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is then good for nothing, but to be cast out and trampled underfoot by men. And you are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. And neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel or a basket, but on a candlestick or a lampstand, so that it gives light to all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. And do not think that I am come to destroy the law and the prophets. For I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill. Assuredly, I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, one jot or one tittle will by no means pass from the law till all be fulfilled. Therefore, whosoever shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men to do so shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does and teaches them shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. And I say to you that unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. And you've heard that it's been said to those of old time, shall not commit murder. And whoever commits murder will be in danger of the judgment. But I say to you, whoever is angry with his brother without a cause is in danger of the judgment. And whoever says to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of the council. And whoever says, thou fool, shall be in danger of hellfire. Therefore, when you bring your gift to the altar, and if you there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift and go your way. First, be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. And agree with your adversary quickly while you are on the way with him, lest your adversary deliver you to the judge, and the judge hand you over to the officer, and you be cast into prison. For assuredly I say to you, you will by no means get out of there until you have paid the last penny. And you have heard that it's said to those of old, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say to you, whoever looks at a woman to lust after her has committed adultery with her already in his heart. So if your right eye causes you to sin, pluck it out and cast it from you. For it's more profitable to you that one of your members should perish than that your whole body be cast into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and cast it from you. For it's more profitable for you that one of your members should perish than your whole body be cast into hell. Furthermore, it's been said that if a man divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you, whoever divorces his wife, except it be for the cause of fornication or sexual immorality, causes her to commit adultery. And whoever marries a woman who is divorced commits adultery. And you've heard that's been said to those of old, you shall not swear falsely, but shall perform your oaths to the Lord. But I say to you, do not swear at all, neither by heaven, for it is God's throne, nor by the earth, for it is His footstool, nor shall you swear by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great King. And don't swear even by your own head, because you can't make one hair white or black. But let your yes be yes, and let your no be no. And whatever is more than this is from the evil one. And you've heard this said, an eye for an eye, and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist an evil person. If a man smites you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. And whoever wants to sue you to take away your tunic, give him your coat as well. And if a man compel you to walk with him 1 mile, walk with him 2. And give to him who asks of you. And to him who wants to borrow, do not turn him away. And you've heard it said, You shall love your neighbor and hate your enemies. But I say to you, love your enemies. Love your enemies. Love your enemies. Bless those who curse you. Do good to those who hate you. And pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be the sons of your Father who is in heaven. For He makes His sun to shine on the evil and the good. And He sends rain on the just and the unjust. If you love those who love you, what good is that? Don't even the tax collectors do the same? And if you only greet your brethren, what do you do more than others? Don't even the tax collectors do the same? Therefore, be perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect. And take heed that you do not do your charitable deeds to be seen by men. For assuredly I say to you, you have your reward. But you, when you do a charitable deed, don't sound a trumpet like the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may receive the glory of men. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. But when you do a charitable deed, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, that your charitable deed may be done in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. And when you pray, don't be like the hypocrites who love to stand praying in the synagogues and on the street corners that they may be seen of men. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. But you, when you pray, go into your room and close your door. And when you have closed your door, pray to your Father who is in the secret place. And your Father who sees in secret will Himself reward you openly. And when you pray, don't use vain repetitions like the heathen do. For they think they'll be heard because of their many words. Therefore, don't be like them. Because your Father knows what you need before you ask Him. After this manner, therefore, you ought to pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. If you forgive men their trespasses, your Father in heaven will forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. And when you fast, Don't be like the hypocrites with a sad countenance, for they disfigure their faces so that they may appear to men to be fasting. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. But when you fast, wash your face and anoint your head, so that you do not appear unto men to be fasting, but unto your Father who is in the secret place, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. And do not lay up for yourselves treasures on this earth, where moth and rust corrupts and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust corrupts and where thieves do not break through and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The light of the body is the eye. And if your eye is good, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is evil, your whole body will be full of darkness. And if the light that is in you is darkness, how great is that darkness? No man can serve two masters. For either he'll hate the one and love the other, or he'll be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. Therefore, I say to you, take no thought for your life, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or about your body, what you're going to wear, what shall we put on? Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Behold the fowls of the air. They don't sow, they don't reap, they don't gather into barns, and yet your Father feeds them. Aren't you much more valuable than they? And which one of you, by worrying, can add one cubit to his stature? And why you worry about your body, saying, what are we going to wear? Behold the lilies of the field, how they grow. They don't toil, they don't spin. And yet I say to you that Solomon, in all of his glory, was not arrayed like one of these. Now, if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, how much more will he clothe you, O ye of little faith? Therefore do not say, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we put on? For after these things the Gentiles seek, and your heavenly Father knows that you need all of these things. But seek first. Seek first. Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about the things of itself. Sufficient unto every day is its own trouble. Judge not, that you be not judged. For with what judgment you judge, you will be judged. And with what measure you use, it will be measured back to you. And why do you say to your brother, let me get that speck out of your eye, when behold, there's a plank in your own eye? And how do you say to your brother, let me get the speck out of your eye, when behold, there's a plank in your own eye? Hypocrite! First, get the plank out of your eye, then you'll be able to see clearly the speck that is in your brother's eye. Do not give that which is holy to the dogs, or cast your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet and turn and tear you into pieces. Ask, and it shall be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it shall be opened to you. For to him who asks, receives. And to he who seeks, he finds. And to him who knocks, it will be opened. For what man among you is there, if his son would ask him for bread, would give him a stone? Or if he asked for a fish, would give him a serpent? Now, if you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give to those who ask him? And whatever you would that people do to you, you do to them. For this is the law and the prophets. Enter in at the straight gate. For wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and many there be who go in thereat. But because straight is the way, gate, and narrow or difficult is the way that leads to life, few there be who find it. And take heed, and beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves. By their fruits you will know them. Do men gather grapes from thorns, or figs from thistles? So also every good tree bears good fruit, and an evil tree bears evil fruit. And a good tree cannot bear evil fruit, neither can an evil tree bear good fruit. And every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and cast into the fire. Therefore, by their fruits you will know them. And not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. And many will come to me in that day and say, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, and in your name cast out demons, and in your name done many wonderful works? Then I will say to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. Therefore, whosoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him unto a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rains descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it did not fall, because it was founded on a rock. But whoever hears these sayings of mine and does not do them, he's like a man who built his house on the sand. And the rains descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell. And great was the fall of it. Friend, where's your house built this morning? Where is your house built this morning? In Luke 6, I'm going to draw your attention. In Luke 6 and verse 46, there is a verse that many times that we use in teaching people who are in denominational error, who refuse to obey the simple commands of Jesus. And the verse is this, and we've all heard it a million times, right? Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do the things that I say? We've all heard it, right? And we've almost always used that verse in that particular way. But can I point out something to you? Luke 6 is the parallel to Matthew 5 through 7. When Jesus said, "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do the things that I say?" He said those words in the context of the words that you have just heard here this morning. How does your life measure to the words that you've heard this morning? Because the answer to that question is the same question, answer to the question, where is your house built? If you're here this morning and you have never obeyed the gospel of Jesus Christ, the same man that gave these great words that you have heard this morning said also, "Except you believe that I am, you'll die in your sins," John 8:24. He said that we have to repent or perish, Luke 13:3 and 5. It means we've got to change the way we think and change the way we live. He said that we must confess our faith in Him before men, Matthew 10:32, or be denied before the Father who is in heaven, Matthew 10:33. And He also said, "He who believes the gospel and is baptized shall be saved." And the gospel is this, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried and raised again the third day, also according to the Scriptures, and that He was seen by many witnesses. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 through 8. Friends, that's the gospel. And if you believe the gospel, and you're willing to live for Jesus, you can put Him on in baptism this morning. Be washed from every sin through the blood of Jesus Christ. Unto Him who loved us and washed us from our sins in His own blood. Revelation 1 and verse 5. If you've been thinking about obeying the gospel, I say to you exactly what Ananias said to Saul of Tarsus. What are you waiting on? Arise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord. And the life that is called, to which we are called by the sermon this morning, is one given to all of us as children of God and must be received with the utmost sincerity and seriousness. If you're here this morning and you realize your life is just not up to par, I'm not saying that you're perfect. I'm saying that you know that you've not been living the life that the Lord Jesus Christ has called you to live. You've not lived that life, but you are a Christian. There's a provision for us as Christians that if we will confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. 1 John 1 and verse 9. And after that, We'll just walk in the light. Obey the gospel and walk in the light. Be restored and walk in the light. For if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all sin. And if you are here this morning and are anyway subject to the invitation and call of our Lord Jesus Christ, we invite, encourage, and plead with you to come. Right now, as together we stand and sing this song.
Because He gave His